Hello and welcome to Open Your Mind Radio. You have myself, Alan James.
And myself, Stephen George. Good evening.
Good evening. It's Sunday the 12th of July 2015. And boy, have me and Steve had a very, very busy but very productive and happy weekend. So before we get into talking about the few bits and pieces that happened, let's find out what the communication channels are first. And then we'll get into the bits and pieces.
Okay, communication channels this evening.
The communication channels are email info@oymireland.com, by phone 046 927 1212, and you can also contact us direct through the OYM chat room.
Yes, 046 927 1212 is the magic number for the studio, as I always say. We've also got, for your listening pleasure, we have the three streams. Anyone who wants to who's on the website will know that the three streams are there. You have the OYM stream, the UWS stream, and the People's Internet Radio stream. We're also going to be monitoring our own chat room for questions for our guest this evening, Max Egan. We're also going to be monitoring People's Internet Radio chat room as well. So hi to everyone that's logged in there. A big wave and hugs and love and kisses and all positive things. We've also got Facebook anti-social media. For those of you who are on Facebook, you'll see the link on the website there on the left-hand side, the little pop-out blue thingy. You can log in there and see what we're all about, what we're up to, and you can comment and do all the other sorts of Facebooky things, post links, etc., etc. We also have the YouTube channel where we have our podcast up there and also some videos as well. And for your listening pleasure, on Apple and iPhone smart devices, you can go to TuneIn Radio. That is the application, I believe, you can get there. And you'll just log in there and type in Open Your Mind or OAM Radio. And you get us on there, so you can check us out and listen to us on the smartphones and the iPhones as well. So, there you go.
Brilliant, Alan. Steve. Okay, before we get on and talk about a few things, we have to, there's a few thank yous that we have to do, because we've had a brilliant weekend this weekend, and it's thanks to a number of listeners that we had the weekend that we had. So we'd just like to say a big thank you for us to Gary. Now, Gary got in touch with us, and he was a long-time listener to OYM Radio. And Gary is a lighting technician for the band Fleetwood Mac. And Gary emailed us and said that he really liked the show and he appreciated what we do. And he said, would we be interested going to see Fleetwood Mac? And myself and Steve said...
Well, we said, no. Yeah, right.
Well, no, we mulled over it, but we said, right, you know, I think, you know, we do deserve a bit of a treat. And obviously Gary was kind enough to offer the tickets. And so we said yes. And not only did Gary get tickets for us, but they were all access passes. And we didn't have to queue up either, which is fantastic. And trust me, you know, it was a brilliant gig. We had a great time. But having the all-access pass meant that we could actually sit in where the sound engineer and the lighting engineer was. And there was a couple of chairs there as well. And as myself and Steve and our other halves are, you know, of a certain age, that we do need to sit down every now and again.
Excuse me?
I don't think we... We would have lasted if we were standing all night.
Just
so
let me ask a quick question, if I may. Who was the first one to use the chairs?
Me.
Yeah. So we may be of a certain age, but you're older.
I know. Yeah. So I avail of the chair, and I have to say, again, Gary got the two chairs set up right on where the lightning crew was, right in front of the stage where you could see the band. It was a brilliant, brilliant seating position,
I have
to say.
So needless to say, Alan and I spent most of the gig looking at all the equipment.
Yeah. I wonder what he's doing. I wonder what button he's pressing, you know?
Yeah. No, it was great.
So a big thank you for Gary for giving us that treat. It was really good. It was brilliant. A brilliant gig. Fleetwood Mac, great band. And much appreciated, Gary. Thanks for doing that. We'd also like a big thank you to Adam. And Adam, let's just say Adam made a donation towards the training that we did. We did 2 days of training on the Pain Genie with Richard Cumbers in Dublin. So we are now kind of Pain Genie stage one experts, I suppose, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
We have our certificate to prove it. And again, a big thank you for Adam for doing that, because it was a surprise and it was much appreciated. It just means that we can now offer treatment free with the Pain Genie for, you know, family, friends, and people who want, you know, there's people out there who can't afford to go to a doctor, they don't have a medical card, they're in pain. And if we can do anything to help out, obviously with the Pain Genie, we will do. And that was the plan. That was the plan all along, and that's what we plan to do. And educate people regarding the Pain Genie, because it has been amazing, Steve, hasn't it? Seen people, you know.
It was mind blown. I mean, look, when we done the demonstration a couple of weeks ago in Navan, with Richard Cumbers, there was several people there and they had treatment and people got up and there was no pain. But even over the weekend, there was people there at the on the course who they had aches and pains, you know. And again, Richard kind of rates things from what's your pain level between the 1 and 10, 10 being severe and 1 being no pain at all. And one of the ladies who was there, she was there and she was just, you know, taking notes and she was participating same as the rest of us. But Jesus, when it came to pain, she was actually had a horrible pain in her neck, and I think she said at one stage it was rated a 9 out of 10. You know, but yet she stuck through it anyway. So Richard immediately brought her up and gave her a 10-minute treatment, and obviously we all gathered round and we watched exactly how it was done, as we did several times over the course of the weekend. And he explained everything. The lady got up maybe 10 minutes later, and he just said to her, "Well, what's your pain level now?" And she just kind of, she walked a little bit and she looked around and we were kind of standing behind her and she turned and faced us and a big smile on her face and she said, "I've no pain. Oh my God, this is amazing." You know, and that was kind of, it got to the stage where everyone was kind of, who was treated with, you know, aches and pains, there was no pain there afterwards. And it got to the stage where you kind of, you know, you weren't kind of going, "Oh, wow, so you've no pain now. God, that's great." No, it was a case of, "Oh, yeah, well, of course you don't have pain now. You've been treated." You know, we seen the device and we seen all the science behind it. And it was a case of, yeah, of course it works. Why wouldn't it work?
It's that the human body is phenomenal. And when you do the training and understand the science of it, well, we're still learning. It's just amazing how it works. And boy, do doctors, they don't have a clue. Seriously, they don't have a clue. So it was a big thank you to Adam. And also, I'd like to say a big thank you. I'm not going to say this person's name. You probably wouldn't want us to say it. But we do have a person who donates to OYM on a regular basis, religiously donates to OYM on a regular basis. He knows who he is and he knows who we're talking about. And I'd just like to say a big thank you to that person, because that person also makes a difference on OYM. All donations, you know, big or small, are appreciated, because it helps us do what we can do. And only for them that we'd be really kind of, you know, off air really. So a big thank you to that person, that he knows who he is. Thanks for doing that. Right, okay, now, our guest on tonight is Max Egan. Now, Max hasn't been on the show for a couple of years, so we've asked Max to come on to give us an update on what's going on. So we're going to be bringing Max in a few minutes. We just have a few things to talk about, and Steve's going to tell us about the IMF and what's going on there.
Yes, the IMF are a shower of not very nice people, but we just kind of rejoicing over the weekend, hoping that, you know, everything was going to go the way we expected it to go in Greece after that, the way they voted was, I think, over 61%, I believe, last weekend. But we just had some information here which said that there was an article during the week that said if the IMF do not do a deal with Greece, that they will consider using Bitcoin. I don't know, I'm guessing that's obviously Greece will consider using Bitcoin. But we also heard during the week as well that Greece were considering going back to the drachma. And there's information online whereby someone stayed in a hotel over in Greece. And when they got their bill, the bill was made out in drachma. And I think it actually said drachma and then the letter EQ after it. Don't ask me what EQ stands for, I don't know. Well, I do. It stands for equalizer over here, but I don't know what it means in Greece. It may mean something completely different. So we're not kind of sure what's happening there. Again, we were on the training thing over the weekend, and we were just kind of so blown away with that and tired when we finished that. I didn't see any news broadcast, and I haven't actually been on the internet since Friday. I haven't been on the net since Friday. Wow. And I didn't actually have any withdrawal symptoms either, so that's a good thing. But we did see some information this evening on the national broadcast propaganda station, Rothschild's Trivial Entertainment. That will be RTE. And they have some information there on their website, basically saying Greece bailout will not come at any price, says Angela Merkel. I'll actually post a link to the article there just in case anyone may be interested in reading it if you're not up to speed. Again, like, it's probably all propaganda anyway. But It says that the, what's the last thing, the actual last thing on it, which I can just throw in first, I suppose, it's about the negotiations. They've actually kind of stopped negotiations for the moment, and it says that they're not going to continue. I think they're going to kick off again tomorrow. And of course, when you have a look at his page, Andy Kenny is there as well. You know, he's there in support. He obviously wants everything to go back on track, and he wants Greece to stay in the Eurozone. But the fact that they're going back into talks, it'll be interesting to see what happens if they do. I mean, wouldn't it be amazing if they actually said, no, enough is enough. You know, we're going to do the right thing by the people. We're going to get out of this, get off this boat or this train, because it's heading for a brick wall, and do the right thing and go back to the drachma. Okay, it might be a little bit tough, but I think for the people and for the future, it's probably the right thing to do. Same as what Iceland did. But of course, you have the likes of the Enda Kennys and all the other leaders of the Eurozone who don't want this to happen and will fight it at all costs. So it's going to be interesting to see where it goes. It says here, Greek Prime Minister Alex, I'm not even going to try and pronounce his surname, said on arrival that he wanted another honest compromise to keep the Eurozone, to keep Europe united. He added, we can reach an agreement tonight if all parties want it. So the fact that he's kind of still in there, he's still kind of thinking that way, well, I suppose that's his job. But I think maybe, you know, if they do the right thing by the people, they'll just get out, get the hell out of it and be done with it.
Exactly.
And that's all I have to say about that, okay, as far as Gump would say.
They'll have to get out. Okay, during the week I was sent over this link, and I kid you not, and you can go over to this link and go to it. And the link is www.humanleather.co.uk, right? Human leather, I kid you not, human leather. And they're saying, what is human leather? It says here, human leather is made from real, full, thickness human skin, just like animal leather products produced from lesser animals. A raw human skin is transformed into the finest grade human leather by using a traditional tanning process. However, human leather is the finest grain leather that is obtainable. It is free from defects and has the smallest grain size, which makes it the smoothest, softest leather on earth. And it says, where does human leather come from? It says, human leather is produced from skin sourced from normal, everyday people. Yes, normal, everyday people. We talk about Satanism and Luciferianism. Well, check this. These people have bequeathed their skin to us prior to their death. There are a few areas of the body, back and abdomen, that have uninterrupted skin coverage and are therefore the best for processing into human leather. These areas allows the maximum usage when being crafted into large coverage items, especially satchels and briefcases. Now, that is unbelievable. A website that's selling products for that, for made out of human leather. Steve, what's the price of these products?
Well, I actually posted the link of the website there into the chat room if anyone wants to check it out, but it's amazing. I mean, you can go onto this website and you can buy a pair of human leather shoes for approximately 18,000 euro onwards or upwards, I suppose, depending on the size. You can get a belt to hold up your strides for 10.5 grand in euro, or $15,750 approximately, and a wallet is from 900 euros or $14,000. It's mental. We actually done the UWS marathon yesterday. We were talking about multitasking, but we actually done a podcast. We recorded a podcast on Friday for the UWS marathon, and we spoke about this, and it beggars belief. I mean, that someone, company out there, is actually prepared to buy the skin off your back. Never mind the shirt off your back, they'll buy the skin off your back as well, make it in some products. Again, you get paid for this. I don't know what the going rate is now for a full suit of, you know, your birthday suit, but they are prepared to pay it. They won't say on the website how much. You obviously have to contact them, and then they'll obviously contact you, and maybe a deal will be done depending on your skin. Can you imagine someone coming out and expecting, you know, there's an old blemish there in your back. No, we can't.
Have to. It's okay, like a mechanic. It's going to cost you.
That's going to cost you. We'd have to remove that blemish first. I don't know. Are you going to do your joke?
Well, no. I said to Steve, you know, wouldn't it be funny if they offered a
hang on. What? If there's any children, if you have any kids there, cover their ears.
No, I said to Steve, can you imagine if they made the poor silver foreskin so when you rubbed it, it turned into a briefcase? But yeah, okay, humanleather.co.uk. I mean, oh, unbelievable. Steve, how's your week?
Well, I've kind of already done that, maybe in reverse. Now, the highlight of my week was actually the Pain Genie seminar, because, say, we went there yesterday, and we were there from 9:15 on Saturday morning, and we had a bit of a drive. It was, you know, we were kind of up early. So we were there for 9:15, and we left, I believe, was somewhere in around 6 p.m. Now, we did kind of have a break or two, and we kind of broke for lunch for about 40 minutes. But it was a full-on day, full of just brilliant information, slides, handouts, booklets, hands-on, healing. We met some great people, and the hands-on stuff on the slides, and they continued on today as well, but there was more kind of, you know, techniques and showing us exactly how to use the device, the proper way to use it, what all the settings did, etc. And we also met some very, very nice people there as well, from all walks of life, as we mentioned earlier. We didn't mention this, we were just saying this to Max, that one of the ladies actually flew over from France to attend the seminar. The training, she actually came over from France with her son, and she said she bought the device after hearing the interview that we did with Richard Cumbers a couple of weeks back. She said she really enjoyed it, and she's a healer herself, so she said she just bought one of the devices, and she's been using it and having great success with it, even though she didn't know what she was doing, she didn't have the technique, she does now. But yeah, and a few other people with other skills that we spoke with, and we learned lots. We met some very, very interesting people. That's really all I can say. It was a weekend. At this stage, we should both be asleep in a sofa somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, that old man pose, you know, where you're kind of lying back in the sofa with your arms folded. That's the position we should be in. But the weekend was so energizing. It really was. It was a breath of fresh air. It was like everyone here on PIR and OIM. You know, it was kind of like being in a room with people on the same wavelength, people who got it, you know, like-minded people, and we were just there with people who got it, you know.
Well,
it was great.
As you said, Steve, we were having dinner and during the lunch break, and we were all sitting around the table talking, and it was all open-minded conversation, and people would say something, and nobody would bat an eyelid, because they were all open-minded,
yeah.
They knew about it, so you didn't have to kind of wait for somebody to turn around and go, oh, that's a conspiracy theory, or, you know the way that happens with some people have closed mind.
Yeah.
And it was great to be in a company like that.
It was really refreshing. I'd say when we were driving home then, we should have been bloody tired, but we weren't. We were kind of, it was like as if, you know, the batteries just got a bit of a charge, and so much information. It's amazing. It really is. Obviously, we know money is tight and all, and as people know, the device that we have, it was paid for by a listener, and we have to, you know, we have thanked them for that. But I'd say if people can get one, or even just go on and have a look at the success rates with, you know, just healing pain, you know, people who are in pain, and just taking people's pain away, it's something that I think it would well be worthwhile saving for, you know, a couple of quid every week if possible, and go get one. Definitely well worth every penny. Anyway, that's kind of my week in the old proverbial nutshell. Yourself?
Yeah, okay, well, before we get Max in, just a couple of things. One, Ticketmaster website, what a complete bloody nightmare, I'll tell you. I dread going to that site again, and anybody else using it, it's just a complete nightmare. So that's all I'll say about that. I had a meeting, went down to a National Land League meeting last week during the week, and there's a good few ideas banded around, good positive ideas of things that may be done, and changes that might be done, things that might be discussed and moved on further. So we'll just keep an eye out for that. But basically, like Steve said, Pain Genie Seminar, very good, really nice people, great group of people, great information shared. We are going to do another show. What I think we might do is do another show with Richard and Tony Hughes to get both of them on at the same time, and talk about just general health, not just the Pain Genie, but general health and what people are going through and suffering, and the issues that, you know, Richard and Tony have come across, a lot of the time based due to austerity and the wrong food and all that kind of stuff, because it's always good, your health is your wealth, as they say. I know it's a cliche, but it really is. But anyway, so what we'll do is we're going to bring our guest in. Now, our guest has been on the show, as I say, a couple of years ago, Max Egan. And Max is a great guest. He's travelled all around the world, and he's been involved with the Palestine issue over there. We'll talk to Max about that and just get a general overview. There's nothing kind of planned or rehearsed or anything like that. We're just going to go with the flow and talk about really what's going on in the world and what's happening. And Max also did an interview there a while ago, which I listened to, which I found very interesting, regarding the desensitizing of people regarding dates. You know, the way we always talk about dates. Oh, this date, this is going to happen and that's going to happen. And they never do. And then people start getting desensitized to it. And it's the date that they put out that they will, maybe something might happen. And we'll be so desensitized, we'll just ignore it. And it was interesting that Max said that, because I kind of agree with that, that they are kind of desensitizing because of so many dates coming out and nothing happens. But not to worry, but we bring Max in. Good evening, Max. How are you?
I'm good, brother. Thanks for asking me on.
Great stuff. Thanks a lot, Max, for coming on. I know you're very busy and you're traveling around. You're in Peru at the moment, which is, you know, fantastic. I'm sure the weather's quite good down there. Is it?
Yeah, it's quite nice. It's a beautiful day. It's been raining, but that's what you get. I'm in the rainforest, so it rains in the rainforest. But yeah, it's good. It's beautiful here. It's not what you'd call winter at all. They only really have two seasons, and yeah, it's a good place to be. I like the jungle.
Excellent, excellent. Well, Max, we have new listeners coming on board all the time to OYM. So for people who haven't heard your podcast from a couple of years ago, do you want to give us a 5-minute bio of who Max Igan is?
Well, about me, really, I'm an ex-musician, to be honest. I'm someone who's lived on the outside of society for most of my life, and so I've been able to research. It's always been a hobby of mine. So for most of my life, I traveled around the world and researched on the side. And then later in life, I became a radio host and filmmaker. I've been making films since about 2008, and I've had a radio show since the end of 2008, doing talk radio across America on American Voice Radio. I don't know what the dial number is because I do it from Australia, but I've been doing that for a while, and I've been traveling around the world doing lectures and just attempting to wake people up to the fact that we've got some serious problems and we need to address them. You know, personally, I think it's a time of great opportunity because I think, never before in history has the workings of the system been laid as bare as it is now. And we've got the interconnectivity that we've got now. You know, we're able to communicate with each other and connect with each other, and we're able to form strategies. And actually, if we can put down our differences, you know, coordinate something into a bit of a global response to what's happening. So I've been trying to do that for a long time and trying to wake people up to the fact that we actually do have the power to change things. I think a lot of the alternative media just presents fear to people. Like, it presents all the problems to people, but it doesn't very often offer them solutions to these problems. And I think we need to take the opportunities we've got available to us to find some solutions and start implementing them.
Yeah, totally agree. Totally agree. I mean, it's okay talking about the things that are going on, and there's a few negatives there, which is understandable. But you, from our point of view, you have to offer solutions as well. It's not just fair. It's not fair just doing, you know, any doom and gloom or negative stories without saying, well, this is the negative, but this is the positive side. And I think, you know, what we try and do here in OYM is to offer that and also talk about, like, as we say, the Pain Genie. What a fantastic device. We can't kind of sing its praises enough because it's benefiting so many people who are in chronic pain that the medical system has let down. And they've nowhere to turn, and the Pain Genie has helped out. But just getting back to, you know, the whole what's going on globally, we've had a number of guests on, and they've talked about this kind of end-time madness. And it seems that the world is kind of going mad. I mean, it really is. I mean, if you step back and look at the jigsaw and put all the pieces together, or as many as you can, you would think the world has just lost the plot. What's your take on that?
Oh, it has. It has. It's completely crazy. The thing is, you've got psychopaths running the planet. That's the problem. And so you've got psychopathic parameters that everybody's forced to operate within, and it creates this incredible schism in people's minds. I mean, people are basically good, I think. You know, we're not competitive, really. We're cooperative. We're competitive because we're forced to live within competitive environments. We're competitive to a degree. We may be competitive sexually. We may be competitive as far as sports or tree climbing or whatever, but as far as when we see another person in need, we want to help them. But we're prevented from doing so by this psychopathic system that we work within, and it creates this schism in human consciousness. It really does. I mean, the world is mad. I mean, it's run by psychopaths. That's the problem. That's why we find it so hard to find remedy from this for this situation. You know, we're always trying to vote people in or vote people out or create some sort of a Band-Aid for a problem. You know, create a relief package for some downtrodden country where we see these starving millions, rather than addressing the problem that created this need to begin with. Mm. You know, we don't ever address that. So we're constantly putting Band-Aids on symptoms. We're running down rabbit holes. We've lost direction. We've lost sight of who we are. And we think that we can appeal to our politicians' better judgment to, you know, start doing the right thing. We don't realize that they're psychopaths. They're mad. You don't go carpet bombing other countries if you've got a working brain, if you're not a psychopath. Mm. You don't start all these wars. You don't enslave your country to a fictional debt system, to a debt-based money system. Like, you know, our money system is privately run, debt-based, designed to create scarcity, creates all the problems that we see in our society. Now, if you've got a problem with crime in your society because you think your society is going mad, well, what creates the crime? It's the perceived scarcity that the people are in.
Yeah.
They have to go and steal to get ahead on the pile, you know. It's the whole money system that creates it all. So we're forced to live within a completely dysfunctional, psychopathic system designed to squash human consciousness into a box and prevent us from ever being ourselves. And so it's no wonder that this is what we get, you know.
Yeah. What is the bigger picture to you? Do you think you have your day-to-day underlying of things that are going on regarding the banks and the psychopaths running the world. Is there a bigger picture that, you know, you can comment on or that you've researched or you've come across and you think, well, there's light at the end of the tunnel. We have to go through this bear canal because of this end-time madness, but there is a bigger picture going on. Have you come across anything like that?
Well, look, there is light at the end of the tunnel, but people have to participate. That's the problem. You know, there's too many people that are waiting to be saved. You know, even with movements that people start, people go and join the movement and they think because I'm part of the movement, I'm going to get a newsletter one day that the world has been changed and we've made a difference. But you're not going to make a difference just by sitting behind your computer and talking about it all. You've actually got to go and apply yourself to the world. You know, I think there is a light at the end of the tunnel. I think all the bad stuff that's happening serves to wake people up. I mean, there's people that are having these conversations now that would never have talked about this stuff 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And now, you know, 8 out of 10 people are saying, hey, there's something terribly wrong. But they just can't see that there's a way out. But really there is. There's all sorts of ways out of this. And that's what you've got to do. You've got to try to find a way. You've got to try to provide at least a pathway to dialogue which will lead to discussions about a solution. You know, and one person can't have the possible. I mean, you know, it's not possible for one person to have the solution. I mean, you might have an idea. Maybe one person will come up with some fantastic idea, but too many people come out there and go, well, yeah, I've got the solution. Here's the way. But we've really got to put everybody's ideas on the table, and we've got to discuss this, but we've got to be prepared to do that, you know, and we can find a way out if we're prepared to discuss it. And this is what I'm trying to do. I've got a movement I'm starting at the moment. Well, not a movement. It's a project called the Full Circle Project, which I'm starting at the moment, which is a way of linking and connecting people up all around the planet so that we can start local action groups and start addressing things at the root cause of the problem. Stop putting Band-Aids on symptoms, you know. If you've got a country full of starving millions, don't send them aid. Go and address the people who created the problem, the legislations and the corporations that created the problem, and get them to go and fix the problem they created. Use the money that they've got. You know, we need to reevaluate this whole system, but we've got to do it by shifting people's focus. You know, we've got to find a way of this whole alternate metering, this whole awakening that we're seeing. We've got to find a way of harnessing people's focus to direct their attention towards the root cause of the problem, which is the corrupt politicians, the corrupt system. I mean, the system is it's systemically dysfunctional, the whole thing. I mean, it needs to be pulled down, and something else needs to be put in its place. But it's got to start somewhere. We've got to use the parameters that people understand, talk to them in a language they understand, get them to direct their attention towards the political system that has created this problem, and fix it. And really, the only thing we need to do to fix it, I firmly believe, is to shift our moral compass and start doing the right thing in all that we do.
Yeah.
That's why we don't even really need to pull down this system and offer a new system to anybody. This is the way we need to do things. All we have to do is start doing the right thing, and the system will change around us organically. It has to.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
Stop operating according to psychopathic parameters. Stop doing things that you know are wrong because it's economically viable to do so. Realize that this is what the economic system is for. It's designed to create scarcity so that everybody's doing the wrong thing, trying to rip everybody off, cutting all these corners, destroying the environment, destroying the planet, you know. And we've got to just stop and pay attention to all of this, you know.
Well, there is, I mean, we definitely are seeing a massive waking up of people over here in Ireland, especially with the Irish War, the protesting that's going on. There is a massive wake up of people going on. And we've heard that through a number of guests that we've had on, that there's going to be a big awakening process where the majority of people will wake up, if not everybody. Something's going to be planned, or something's going to happen, where without a shadow of a doubt, people will go, right, I got it, you know, this is what's going on, they're corrupt, the whole system's going to be exposed. And there's one key thing, or maybe there's a couple of key things, that are going to happen to do this. And I was talking to Steve about this, and I said, well, what could it be? What could it be that they would do that the majority of people, if not everybody on the planet, would wake up to and realize? So I kind of threw an idea around, and I thought, well, maybe because 9/11 was such an impact on the world and the amount of people that died and what happened, maybe the evidence of who was behind it and, you know, trials and people being arrested would be a massive wake-up for the planet. But that's the only thing I can kind of think of offhand. What would you think? I mean, I know I'm putting you on the spot because I didn't ask you this question before we went live. But would you think that's kind of feasible to come out with something like that, or would there be something need to be bigger to wake people up?
Well, no, that would succeed in waking a lot of people up. I mean, a lot of people are already aware of who carried out 9/11 and what's actually going on with it, like with Rebecca Roth's book. Have you read Rebecca's book?
No, I haven't, no.
There's a fantastic book she put out as a novel called Methodical Illusion, a story of an airline stewardess. And it's a big 9/11 truth bomb in the book. And she nails a lot of the unanswered questions of 9/11. There's enough evidence now to really convict certain people of certain acts. And that would serve to wake a lot of people up. It's whether the mainstream media will ever present that information to the world is the problem. Mm. I mean, the amount of information we've got out there now that would wake people up, it's already out there. It's all in the public domain. The problem is that the media just doesn't present it to the people. And everyone just believes what their television tells them. Now, the numbers are dropping, though. The television numbers are dropping. But still, they do control consensus, they control the newspapers, they control the television. And if you don't see the revolution in the newspaper or the television, then most people aren't going to believe it. That's the thing, though. The revolution will not be televised. It will never be televised. They won't ever tell you what's going on. You had, what, 40,000 people protesting outside the BBC a couple of months ago. What didn't even make the news.
Yeah.
And so that's the problem, is that the mainstream media just doesn't pass the information on. But yeah, 9/11, I mean, if there were convictions of that, maybe it would wake up people. But will we see that? Because, I mean, ultimately, if there were convictions over 9/11, it couldn't just be the perpetrators. It would have to be the media as well.
Yeah.
Because the media are the ones who sold the lie to the public. I mean, we all saw through it, and we saw how much disinformation they saw. You had the BBC, again, reporting the collapse of Building 7 20 minutes before it came down.
Yeah.
I mean, that shows complicity straight there. Mm. So, you know, that they're the ones who have sold the war on terror. They're the ones who sold all the war propaganda that allowed the invasion of Iraq. I mean, the media are as guilty, if not more guilty, of war crimes than the politicians that have carried out the crimes. So that's the problem. You know, even if there is convictions, how will the media downplay it? Will it cause some type of a global awakening, or will the media just simply spin it the way they do, and it will be business as usual and just a few pollies hung out to dry, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, actually, funny we talk about, you know, changes taking place as well, and obviously we're going to have to touch base on Greece because the way Greece is at the moment. Now, we know that last Wednesday, the New York Stock Exchange went down and they said, oh, it's a computer glitch. But yeah, people in the know have said, well, they pulled the plug because the Chinese stock market lost something like $3.2 trillion. And they were getting scared that it would go down even further. So we do know this is a massive Ponzi scheme, the whole financial system, and chances are it is going to collapse. There's a lot of, you know, again, talk about September being a poignant month for a number of reasons. And I was just curious, what have you heard your side? I mean, obviously you've been, I'm sure you've listened to Greece and what happened there. And I'm not too sure, Steve, you've looked at Greece before we went on air. What did you say? What was happening there with Greece?
Well, what I seen was happening was that they were going to go back into talks, but they're not going to. It's cancelled for today anyway. But they're going to go back into talks tomorrow, Monday, and their financial minister is saying that, you know, they'll kind of explore more avenues to try and stay in or keep Europe together. Again, I personally think it's the wrong thing, but that's just my personal opinion.
Okay, no problem. What's your take on that, Max?
Look, they'll do what they can to keep it together, but I hope Greece pulls out. I mean, I hope they do. It'd be the smart thing to do. The European Union's destined to fail. I mean, it's like you say, it's a Ponzi scheme. It's just a mechanism to milk the wealth of Europe.
Yeah.
That's what it is. It's ridiculous. It's absurd, the whole thing. So I hope they do pull out. I hope they do default on the loan. They don't owe anything anyway. The IMF didn't lend them anything. No bank ever lent anybody anything. It's a scam.
Exactly, yeah.
The whole thing is a scam. But, so, I mean, we need to cancel all debt, cancel all global debt straight away, and that'd be a good start to, you know, alleviating the world's problems straight away. I mean, all of the debt that's been accumulated by the banking cartels is all ill-gotten. Whether it's legal or not, it's all ill-gotten. You know, legislation that doesn't serve the people is invalid legislation as far as I'm concerned. And, I hope they do. I hope they default on the loan. I hope they pull out altogether. I'd like to see the whole European Union, go to where it deserves, which is the path of memory, you know, a bad memory.
Yeah, well, I think that will probably be a contagion. I think that will spread around Europe and the dominoes will fall, you know, Italy, Portugal, maybe Ireland. I mean, our politicians are just so far up Angela Merkel's arse. It's unreal. It's just...
They need to get out of it as quickly as possible because it's going to go down. I mean, the American dollar may be strong at the moment, but they owe so much money everywhere. They owe so much money to China, and there's so much that's just propped up around the planet that, you know, people need to get out of this scheme as quickly as possible because it can't last. It absolutely can't last. And, you know, BRICS bank's due to come online. Who knows? I mean, there could be all sorts of things happen in September. It may be a smokescreen. Maybe they can ramp up some more wars and just keep it propped up and keep the petrodollar strong a little longer. But people need to start pulling away from it. They need to start pulling away from the empire and this imperialist nightmare that the West and the banking cartels are creating. They really do. It's look what it's doing to the planet. Look what it's done to the Middle East. I mean, the Middle East, everything that we're seeing in the Middle East, this is not Arab terrorists running around creating havoc everywhere. Why would these Arab terrorists be running around terrorizing all their own countries? It's ridiculous. The whole thing's been created by the West, and it's all, they've funneled so much money out of the United States in there now. I mean, this is what we're doing to the world. This is what these people are. They staged 9/11, killed 3,000 of their own people, then went out and killed about 4 million people since then, knowing all the time they're innocent. This is who's running the banking system. This is who's running the empire. And people need to call it for what it is and step out of it as quickly as they can, I think.
Definitely. And you've been over in Palestine, so you've seen things firsthand. Tell us about your experiences, what you've seen over there.
Oh, mate, the situation in Gaza is absolutely atrocious. It's a situation that you wouldn't put up with for a day. And that was in 2012 when I was there. Now it's 10 times, 20 times worse than what it was when I was there. That last 51-day bombing campaign they did last year, and it's been a year since they did that campaign. There still hasn't been one building rebuilt. You've got thousands of homeless people, thousands of injured people. The border's closed, they're held under siege, and they're a shining light to us all. The people of Palestine are a shining light to us all. And this is something that I use in my talks as well. Excuse me. The situation in Gaza and the situation in Palestine is actually providing an opportunity for the entire world, because if law is real, if international law means anything at all, and when you look at the actions of Israel, that's very debatable, but if it does, then the existence, the very existence of Gaza Strip is a war crime, because according to the Fourth Geneva Convention, collective punishment is a war crime. Building settlements in occupied territory is a war crime. You can't just go into another country and start building houses in disputed territory, you know. But this is what they're doing in Palestine. They've been doing it for 60 years. So the very existence, doesn't matter what Israel, what else it's done, doesn't matter about them dropping white phosphorus on them and bombing churches and mosques and schools and targeting children. There are thousands of children in jail in Israel as well, the Palestinian children, 8-year-old kids and stuff, and they get taken away and locked in jail for 10 years and subject to brutal treatment. There's all sorts of stuff going on there. It's an apartheid system. But apart from all of that, the very existence of Gaza Strip is a war crime, according to the Fourth Geneva Convention. Therefore, any country, any government that is funding or supporting Israel is funding and supporting war crimes according to the Fourth Geneva Convention. Therefore, it is the duty of all the people in these countries to withhold taxes from these governments and to hold these governments accountable for their actions, because they're all supporting war crimes. You know, Stephen Harper's supporting war crimes. David Cameron is supporting war crimes. Barack Obama, Tony Abbott, they're all supporting war crimes because they're all funding Israel, and Israel is perpetuating Gaza Strip, which itself is a war crime. Its very existence is collective punishment. This is a war crime under the Fourth Geneva Convention, and this provides every single person and every Western nation that is supporting Israel, this provides all of these people with an opportunity to rein our governments in and pull these criminals out of office and have them held accountable for their actions. Every single one of us. We could do this if people would just seize the opportunity that the Palestinian people are giving us. And these are beautiful people. They have such light in their eyes. They are not terrorists. They are not what the media presents them as being. Israel is an aggressive nation. It's been an aggressive nation ever since it was formed. It controls the media, and so it's able to cry victim all the time, but it is the main source of instability in the Arab world and has been for the last 60 years. As Tommy called that for what it is as well. And I think it's a great opportunity, and we should seize this opportunity, and we could heal the situation in Palestine, and we could heal our own countries via the opportunity that Palestine is providing. And if we don't, then the way of Palestine will be the way of the world, because what we see there is a system of warehousing and surplusing human beings. And this will be coming to a town near you if we don't pay attention to this situation. And the people in Ireland, I mean, my God, what you guys have suffered in England, talk about warehousing and surplusing, you know, you guys above all should be able to identify with what's going on in Palestine, you know?
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, there's an awful lot going on over here with the water meters, and it's not just that. That's the water meter issue is just the topsoil. It's everything underneath. I mean, what the government is doing, the suicides over here, the evictions over here, it's just unbelievable. And yet, you know, you try and talk to these politicians in power and they just don't get it. But then again, maybe they do get it, but they're just controlled by Europe and they're told what to do. They're puppets and psychopaths. And that's why I call them parasites, because they live off the host, which is us. So it's understandable. Have you ever been called an anti-Semite?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, people call me anti-Semitic all the time because I speak out for Palestine. And I'm not anti-Semitic. I'm very anti the Israeli government because they're a brutally apartheid regime. But most of them aren't even Semites. They're Europeans that converted to Judaism back in 740 AD and migrated there. They're not even Semites. So, you know, it's a smokescreen that they've created. The whole term anti-Semitism is a smokescreen they've created. You know, I've got Jewish friends. I don't have a problem with Jewish people. Yeah. I've got a problem with the actions of Israel. And it wouldn't matter who's doing it. It doesn't matter what the country is.
Yeah.
If it was Rwanda doing this, I'd be speaking out against Rwanda. If it was Slovenia doing it, it doesn't matter who the country is.
Yeah.
You can't treat people the way these people are treating the Palestinians. It's just not on.
But,
you know, all the stuff that we're seeing from our politicians, everything you've just described as going on in Ireland, this is all abuse of office. All these politicians are in abuse of office. And our problem is that when we try to address this, we go for the cloud of government. We go for the smoke, and you can't address government. Government's a cloud. It's a smoke screen. It's a fictional entity. It's not real. It's just an idea. What you've got to do is you've got to go for the person who sits in the office who signed off on the legislation. And if there's legislation put in place above him which prevents you from holding him accountable, then find out who enacted that legislation, because, you know, you can't have a government that has removed itself of accountability. You know, if the people cannot have their government being held accountable for their actions, and you can have no security in your nation, if the government is enacting legislation removing themselves from accountability, this is a breach of national security, because the nation cannot be secure if the government cannot be held accountable. And that's the problem with the media as well. That's the job of the media. They're supposed to be a government watchdog. They're supposed to hold government accountable for their actions, and they're not doing it. And so what we have to do as people is shift our focus to this abuse of office that is happening right around the planet with all of our politicians, and call things for what they are. You know, stop putting band-aids on symptoms. This is what I'm trying to do with Full Circle Project. We've got this thing with the project called, and if anybody wants to look at it, they can go to my website, which is thecrowhouse.com, and there's the Full Circle website. There's a link to it there. And the Full Circle website is called fullcircleproject.net. And you can go there, you can sign up to the Community Connector. We've got templates there. And the Community Connector, you can connect with people in your area, find people in your area, local people to connect with, form an action group. We've got templates there. You can form circles of five, start these action and discussion groups, and start finding local issues and redirecting your attention to what caused the issue. Don't put a band-aid on the issue. Don't put a band-aid on the symptom. Turn your attention to the politician that created the problem and go for the throat and charge these people with abuse of office. You may not get anywhere. You may not find you can get anywhere through the legal system, but you're sure as hell going to get people's attention. And you can create a new meme. You can create a new idea in the minds of people and help them realize that they are powerful. And that the people who sit in these positions of assumed power and who hold these offices are just people, just like us. These are people we employ to manage our infrastructure for us, who are doing a damn awful job and abusing the office that they hold by giving themselves powers they do not deserve. They are serving corporations. They are allowing this planet to be destroyed, and we're allowing them to do it because we believe that all of these stupid rules they write on pieces of paper are actually law. But they're not. It's legislation that these psychopaths make up in order to milk the wealth of the people. And it's time we called it for what it is. Mm. But we've got to unite. We've got to unite in a cohesive response, but a response that has no leaders, a response that is grass fires right around the planet, but interconnected grass fires. So we can all monitor what we're doing. We can see what action's working, who's doing what. We can coordinate. We can do it globally. And we can shift our focus to where it needs to be, and that's to the root cause of the problem. Bring us full circle back to our natural state of abundance. That's the plan. Create a movement that has no leaders. It's a movement that is not a movement. It's simply a mechanism. It's grass fires right around the planet, and a mechanism that we can use to link up together. So please go and check that out. I really have great plans for it, and I have great hopes for it. Mm. And everybody that I've brought the idea to has really gotten on board with it. People can see the potential of what we can do here. And I believe by taking the approach of abuse of office and all this sort of stuff, by stepping into their fiction for this, you can speak to the man on the street in a language they understand. And when you start bringing this to them and talking to them about abuse of office and that politicians are simply people we employ to manage our infrastructure, you see a little spark of spiritual enlightenment go off inside them. It starts this little ball rolling because you're speaking to them in a non-confrontational language that they already understand within a legal system that they believe works. So it helps to wake these people up, these sleeping masses, and that's who we need to reach. We need to reach the sleeping masses that still watch the TV. So that's what I'm trying to do with this. And once this little awakening goes off, then we can start dealing with what's behind the mechanism of government that actually controls it, like the banking cartels and everything. But the government is the barrier that is between us and that which controls government. It's the legislation that these public trustees enact that we choose to go along with because we believe it's law, and we never really get through it because we're all disunited and therefore disempowered, and every response we have to this is compartmentalized. It's someone trying to put a band-aid on a symptom rather than all of us uniting together into one global shift in consciousness and shift in attention to the root cause of the problem and addressing that. We start doing that, we're going to see some change coming back pretty quickly.
Has anybody said to you that sounds a little bit like socialism?
Well, I don't know. Nobody said that, but I don't think it is socialism. I think that what we're doing here is you're going to create a new meme in the minds of the people, and you're going to find lower-level politicians starting to stand up and call abuse of office as well. And they're going to realize that we need transparency in our political system. We need to put humanity at the back of the top of the food chain. We need to have a political system that serves mankind rather than us serving the system. We've got psychopaths running the world at the moment. So, I mean, I don't know what sort of an ism you'd call it, like freeism, but I know we can't continue on the path that we're going. And I firmly believe that if we can empower people into remembering who and what they are and realizing that they do have the power to make change, and if we start doing the right thing in all that we do, then the system will shift around us. We won't have to create any type of ism. All we have to do is shift our focus and shift our attention of who and what we are, and the system will change around us organically. But we need to start implementing some accountability to these psychopaths that are running the planet. And this, I believe, is a mechanism we can use to do it. Hey, I don't know what the future looks like, and I don't know what the new system will look like. But I believe there's been a series of steps that have brought us to this point, and we have to find a way of reversing the sequence. We've got to do it in a simple enough way that people can understand it and not be threatened by it and want to get on board. And something that's going to snowball quickly enough to actually bring about some change quickly and stop this system in its tracks. So I don't know whether it's socialism, I don't know what you'd call it, but I don't know what the future looks like, but I know it can't continue in the direction it's going. So however we can put a spoke in the wheels, I'm all for it.
Yeah, I think we can both agree on that. Steve has a few questions for you there, so I'll pass over to Steve.
Yes, a couple of questions coming in for you there, Max. And just basically, going back to Europe, Hammy come in. Hammy is wondering, is Max aware of the supposed plan to boot Greece out of the EU temporarily as a scare tactic? And Hammy says, personally, he'd jump at the chance because to do that, they'd have to write off the debt.
Well, yeah. I mean, they may do it and try to bring it out as a scare tactic. And you'd see they just put all sorts of, you know, economic marginalisation on them because they were back to the drachma and all sorts of stuff. There'd be all sorts of book work we've got to do now and all sorts of things. So, yeah, I mean, there's a chance that they do that. But, yeah, I'd say they should. I mean, jump at the chance. Yeah, they'd cancel the debt. And then what do? You're back to where you were. You're back to something better than what it was. But, I mean, they'll try to do it as a scare tactic. They try to make us believe that we do need the nanny state. We do need them to look after us. Oh, my God, you can't go out on your own. It's a big, dangerous world out there. You know, so that may happen. That may happen indeed. But, I hope Greece, like I said, I hope they do default. I hope they get out. I hope all the countries pull out. I'd like to see the EU completely fail because it's dysfunctional. It's designed to fail. It's going to turn all of Europe into the third world if people let it continue the way it's going. So it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Oh, yeah, definitely interesting times ahead. As we said earlier, they're supposed to be starting, kicking off more talks tomorrow. So it'll be very interesting to see what happens. You know, no one really knows where it's going to go.
The talks are always like, you've got to play by our rules. Okay, yeah. we'll repackage it and we'll give you our rules with a different coating. Do you like this one? Okay, well, how about this flavour? You know, it's the same thing, of course. I mean, the scare tactics, I mean, they're probably just going in there and threatening them, saying, listen, you can't do this. If you do, we're going to screw you, you know.
Yeah, but then again, if they do threaten them, they don't have to look any further than Iceland. I mean, you know, because as I point out to people all the time, you don't hear anything in the news about Iceland anymore, because when you know people in Iceland and you contact them and they say, yeah, everything is actually, we rejected the IMF and everything is okay now. We had it a little bit tough there for a while, but the economy is starting to normalise again, you know. So, I mean, that's why I think it would be a benefit to Greece to do it.
Much smaller population, though, in Iceland.
No, it's only, 375,000 people.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Okay, we'll move on anyway. Joan was wondering, when we were talking about Gaza, Joan, how can we get a solution to Gaza when the big powers don't mind what goes on? Once the population is extinguished, and how does Max see, what does Max think Ireland should do?
Well, like I said, the best opportunity for Gaza is for us to clean up our own backyard and hold our own politicians accountable, withhold taxes from them, start asking them to show cause where they shouldn't be held accountable for war crimes that they're supporting by supporting what's going on in Gaza Strip. This is really the only solution. I mean, Israel is not going to stop what they're doing, and they're not going to go in there and completely destroy them. Sorry about the helicopter flying over.
Sorry, it's coming in to pick you up, is it?
Yeah, something like that. The army must have heard the transmission.
Yeah.
Over the Amazon.
We'll just listen for the torpedo.
Israel is not going to stop what it's doing, and they're not going to just wipe them out altogether either, because they need them there. They need them there so that they're the victim. They've got to have people there. They've got to have this terrorist cell embedded into their fold, you know what I mean? Because that way they're the constant victim. They also use Gaza as a place to go in and test their weapons. So what we've got to do is call it for what it is. And we've got to start calling our governments out for what they are and calling the media out for what they are. And we've got to stop supporting our own governments, because it's our governments that are supporting Israel. I mean, the United States gives them $7 million a day, for God's sake. I mean, it's ridiculous, you know. So,
well, how do we go about withholding taxes, Max? Because over here, I'm guessing it's probably the same in every country.
I reckon you've got to start writing letters and asking them to show cause where they shouldn't be held accountable for war crimes. Do you fund Israel? Do you offer aid to Israel? Well, here's the Fourth Geneva Convention indicating collective punishment is a war crime. Is there a clause somewhere in the Irish Constitution that says you're not allowed to support war crimes? I'm sure there is. You could find it, find out what it is, somewhere in your constitution. There'll be something that says you may not, either Terrorism Act or something. You cannot attribute money to anything that is knowingly maybe used to contribute to war crimes or terrorism or whatever. Well, if your government is offering aid to Israel in any way, then your government is funding a nation that is in the process of carrying out war crimes. It's not a debatable point. You don't have to go into any of the local wars they've just had. Just the fact that Gaza Strip exists is a breach of the Fourth Geneva Convention. This is a war crime. Therefore, it is your duty to not pay taxes to this government if this government can be found to be supporting this war crime. And that would be a great support to the people in Gaza. There's also the BDS movement, the boycott, sanction, divestment movement. But, I mean, that does a certain amount. But with the United States giving them $7 million a day anyway, how much do you expect it's going to do? You know?
Yeah.
I mean, it shows solidarity. But speaking out, getting the word out, always referring to it as Palestine, not as Gaza and West Bank, not just as Gaza and West Bank, and not as Arabs in Palestine, but as Palestinians. You know, they're trying to do everything they can to just say these people are just Arabs that are squatting in Israel. And, you know, these sorts of things help. Just getting the word out to people, speaking about the truth in Gaza, spreading information about it, checking the news. You could just get a news feed. Send me the local news on Gaza every day and post it on your website. Send it out in newsletters to people. Just help people become aware of it. There's an Indiegogo campaign a friend of mine is running in Gaza, actually a young kid who wants to buy a camera so he can become a journalist. Support that. Support things like that. It'd be great, you know.
Yeah, we have stuff up here. It kind of goes up on a daily basis through social media, through Facebook. Different people, they find out what produce in local stores is being imported from Israel, and you know, they have all these things up on Facebook saying, you know, boycott this and boycott that and don't buy this and don't buy that. And maybe that's just their way of doing it. But I mean, just again going back to withholding taxes, I mean, we've had a kind of a bit of a grassroots movement here in Ireland where we try to educate people that there is no law in the Irish Constitution or in Irish law that says we have to pay tax. But yeah, we still try to wake the people up. And even though a lot of people realise that this law doesn't exist, that we've had confirmation from a girl I know in the tax office as well, but again, before you even get your wages here, it's taken out at source, so the government is actually robbing you before you get your money anyway. So it's kind of it's a bit of a difficult situation to withhold taxes. I mean, I'd love to do it. I don't think they deserve any of our taxes, to be perfectly honest.
Well, you got to try to create a movement, get this meme in the minds of people, you know, start talking to them about it, you know, like this is a war crime. We're funding a war crime. By paying taxes to this government, we're funding a war crime. And look at all the stuff these governments do. Any war they're supporting, it's ridiculous. I mean, I don't know how the Irish government is as far as the war on terror in the Middle East. I don't think it gets involved in England that much, does it? I mean,
no.
You guys don't sort of go and party on the war line with all these other guys, I don't think. So maybe different in Ireland, I don't know. But I still think Gaza Strip is providing an opportunity for all of this because it's a breach of international law, just the fact that it exists. So yeah, that's one opportunity. That's one way, you know. But I mean, all these things. If you've got austerity measures in your country, well, this is creating a humanitarian crisis. And the people of Ireland, the nation of Ireland, are the people of Ireland. You are the national identity. Separate the nation from the nation state. The nation state is the government. And hey, I don't even really believe in nations. We made them up. But
yeah,
a lot of people do. They've got this national identity. They're proud to be Irish. Okay, we'll use that. So the people of Ireland are the nation of Ireland, so therefore any threat to the people of Ireland is a threat to national security. So if politicians are enacting legislation, creating austerity measures, and putting people in a state of hardship in order to support a privately run financial system, I mean, what is this? What is this? Call it for what it is. This is a joke. Show cause or you shouldn't be held in abusive office for even supporting this system. Show cause. Show cause. Show cause why you shouldn't be held accountable for the humanitarian crisis you are creating by impoverishing the people of this nation in order to pay a debt to a privately run financial system when all of this debt has been ill-gotten. All of it has been the result of deception, you know, and a completely fictional system, a system that is totally off-kilter and off-balance and designed to milk the wealth of the people. Let's just call it for what it is. And what, you've got legislation which prevents me from saying this or calling it for what it is? Well, who wrote that? Because you guys are just people. You're people we employ to manage our infrastructure for us. And you're doing a damn awful job. If you want proof, Exhibit A, the Earth. Every single problem we've got on this planet, whether it be war, whether it be homelessness, whether it be oil spills, Fukushima, it doesn't matter what it is, it's the result of corporations cutting corners due to legislation government put in place to allow them and due to them cutting corners to support this corrupt, privately run financial system that exists due to legislation government put in place that allows it. So screw you, people. Call it for what it is. You know, mankind has to stand up and stop being politically correct. Stop dealing in a paper-based reality and thinking that we've got to let these psychopaths destroy the world because they wrote it all down on paper that they're able to. I mean, get up and say that to your local community. Maybe that'll shift a few bums off seats. But, you know, we've got to do something, brother. We do.
Yeah, you'd be surprised over here, though. You'd be very surprised over here, Max, because I think there's a lot of sleeping Irish over here. I mean, even with the whole water protest and the austerity, that only woke a certain amount of them up, but there's still a lot of people, you know, and I think we're just going to have to forget about
them. How can you charge people for water? Water's a basic right of life, for God's sake.
Not at all, no. One of our politicians is on record as saying, you know, it doesn't just fall from the sky, you know, he's actually on record saying that.
It shows how much they know, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think they have a factory somewhere where they manufacture it.
Yeah, this guy obviously doesn't have a working brain, you know. Doesn't just fall from the sky.
No, that's what he's actually on record, because the way it works over here is, obviously the water falls from the sky, but don't tell the politicians that, they won't believe you. But the water falls from the sky, then it's treated, they put the fluoride in, you know, to help our teeth, you know, give us a nice smile, and then it's pumped into the homes, and out of general taxation, we already pay for that. And now they're just looking for more ways to make money, so they decided they'd set up a company called Irish Water. So now they're trying to get us to pay for it again, and they've gone around putting in meters, water meters. And a lot of the country has actually woken up and has protested and has been quite successful. There's been a lot of scuffles between members of the Irish police and protesters as well. And of course, you can imagine the way the media have a field day with that. It's all, as far as the media is concerned, it's all one-sided. But yeah, they're trying to charge us. I believe it's not only twice, but three times. I think it's a third time for the water, because allegedly we already pay for it twice, once through general taxation, once through motor taxation. I think that goes into the pot as well. And now it's our time again through meters. But yeah, it's crazy.
We have our meter fairies, Steve.
Oh, we do have the meter fairies. Yeah, they seemingly, if you contact the meter fairies, they will come along in the dead of night, Max. And if you have a meter, poof, it'll be gone the next morning.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah, wonderful stuff. I mean, how dare they do all this sort of stuff, you know? They're out of control. They really are. But we've got to start calling it for what it is.
Absolutely. Like everything else, they're doing it because, as you said, you're right. They're only doing it because we're letting them away with it.
Yeah, and they're supporting this financial system. I mean, these guys will keep going until they turn the Earth into the moon. And then they'll say, oh, my God, I'm going to need to go and find another planet to exploit because I still owe money to the bank. You know,
yeah.
That's just the way they are. They'll just keep going until they've destroyed the entire planet. That's what this financial system is designed to do. It'll just keep going. We everything we harvest, we make to break. You know, they're just finding new ways of milking money from the people in order to try to pay off their debt to the banksters who run the whole show anyway. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we could use the money owned by the banksters to house, feed, and clothe every man, woman, and child on this planet. And they'd still have plenty left over.
Yeah.
So, you know, we've got to call things for what they are and stop going along with this system. It's ridiculous.
Max, Jimmy is wondering, have you any new information on the flotilla that got hijacked on the way to Gaza?
All I know is that they've been hijacked there in Israel at the moment. I don't know if anybody's been released yet. We expected that. We expected them to go down. It's a shame it wasn't a trade mission. I mean, we've got to stop sending aid to all these places, and we've got to start opening them up for trade. Gaza should be allowed to trade. We've got to end the siege in Gaza. But as far as I know, they were just hijacked in international waters by Israeli pirates, and they were taken to Israel, and that's where they are. They'll probably all be deported back to wherever they came from, and the ship will be confiscated, of course.
Okay. I have another question here, but it's kind of backtracking a little bit. I should have actually asked you this when we were kind of talking about the 9/11. But Chris was wondering, in relation to the 9/11, do you believe that Putin has the smoking gun info on 9/11? And if so, do you think he'll release that information?
Look, he may have, but I mean, Putin's a player. If Putin's got smoking gun information on 9/11 and he decides to release it now because he's annoyed with the way America's treating Russia, my question to Putin is, well, if you've had this information for the last 14 years, why the hell didn't you release it in September 2001, in 2011? You know?
Yeah, so now that we may throw him in with the rest of them, he's just as guilty then for having the information and not sharing it.
Why didn't he release it? If he's got it, why isn't it already released? Why isn't it out there in the public domain? I mean, he may release it, but he's a player. Come on, they're all players.
Okay, yeah. Just talking about, we're talking about global issues, but we've had a few guests on talking about things outside of the planet, and you talked about, you know, obviously these oligarchs, these psychopaths, when they use up all the resources of the planet, they might go to the moon or somewhere else. Now, we've had guests on who've actually confirmed that there are, you know, so the Solar Warden Project, which is and conglomerates coming together, big companies out there already starting to, you know, secret technology, but they're out there doing that already. And that by no means doesn't surprise me whatsoever, you know, because they want to have their new world order. They want to have the one world government and the one world currency. And obviously it's all about resources. And when they're using up with Fukushima and the Amazon forest and everything else, they're using everything up. And so the next stage would be, common sense would be to go and look at, you know, planets that are near that they can get to start mining and get the resources from them.
Well, yeah, they could. There's a possibility. But, I mean, I don't know. I can only speculate on all that sort of stuff. It'd be very hard to get to other planets in other solar systems. I mean, it's a long, long way to another solar system, you know.
Okay. What about the likes of wormholes? I mean, that's
That's possible. Yeah, it's possible. There's wormholes. It's possible that the sun is a wormhole.
Yeah, because Ben Rich, he was the chairman and CEO of Skunkworks, and in the 1990s, before he died, he said we now have the technology to bring ET home.
Well, yeah. I don't know. I mean, it's possible that there's all sorts of off-world stuff going on. I don't usually go there on my show because, I mean, all I can do is speculate on it. You know, I can read other people's books and other people's speculation, and I can speculate on their speculation, but without any first-hand knowledge, I just don't know.
Yeah,
and
so yeah.
That's really why I don't go there too much on the show. I mean, if people want to come on and talk about it, that's fine, but I don't go there. And I mean, I try to deal with stuff I've got first-hand knowledge on or stuff that I'm informed about, not stuff that I can only speculate on. But, I mean, it's interesting. There's all sorts of stuff. There's all sorts of possibilities. I mean, there's the big seed banks they're storing, you know, all the seeds underground. There's all the underground bases as well. So maybe they're preparing for something. Who knows, you know?
Do you feel, I mean, obviously we talked about the financial system and the potential of that collapsing with China losing $3.2 trillion, and we were told that as soon as you see the derivatives market going down, that's the start of the collapse. Now, there's a lot of people talking about September, and we don't want to get caught up in dates for obvious reasons, because they come and go. But what you said on the radio show that I listened to was very poignant because of the desensitization and them doing this on purpose. Do you want to talk about that?
Well, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of people been crying wolf. I just found it interesting that, and I mentioned it on that show. I think, I can't remember who it was with. It was on an interview, I think. But the thing is that all of the pieces are there. I've never seen all the dominoes in place before, and it's very conceivable that China could foreclose on its loan in September, and we may see the petrodollar collapse and a new global currency take over, in which case Jane Helm could kick in. We could see America go into martial law, all sorts of stuff. I mean, all the pieces are there. It's possible. It's also a Shemitah year. Yeah. And on Shemitah years, these are seven-year cycles. Big things happen on Shemitah years. And this is actually a number seven of the seven-year cycle, so it's a big one. So we could see something big happening this year. All the pieces are there. I'm not saying that it will, but there's a possibility that it could. I mean, it's interesting that all the dominoes are lined up now. And when we see what's going on in Europe, when we see all the wars in the Middle East, all the distraction that's going on everywhere, we see Jade Helm, we see the closing of the Walmarts. Yeah, it's possible that things could turn ugly in September. And all they've really got to do to bring about a revamping of this reality, if you want to put it that way, is to turn the power off the dollar. They don't need to have another big terror attack like September 11. They don't need to have anything that major. They could simply turn the value off the currency, and we'd see a pretty big meltdown in the United States. And the United States can never pay its debt to China. That's the thing. You know, and you know, China virtually owns the United States now, and you may see, you know, them foreclose on their loan, and suddenly they own the place, and suddenly the Chinese work ethic comes into being in America. You never know; anything could happen. It could go any direction. I mean, empires come and go. You know, everything seems pretty permanent the way it is now, but I'm sure the Roman Empire thought that as well. I'm sure Genghis Khan thought that. I'm sure the Khazars thought that. I'm sure everybody thought that when their empire was at its fullest, it all seemed all nice and permanent. But nothing is ever permanent, and the American empire cannot last, especially in its current form. And it would be very beneficial to the rest of the world, perhaps not the Western world, but it would be very beneficial to a lot of places if the American dollar was not the reserve currency, because America is causing a lot of damage around the planet, has been for a long time.
Yeah.
Whether it's Israel doing it via America, whether it's the bankers doing it via America, it doesn't matter. The military machine that is the United States is doing an awful lot of damage, and it would be in everybody's interests if this country did not hold the global reserve currency. We've got to call things for what they are, so anything's possible. Will it happen? I don't know. Perhaps Jade Helm is an AI program, like people have been saying. Perhaps it's simply a way of mapping the human terrain. But anything's possible. It's a Shemitah year, and I wouldn't be surprised if we see something major happen in September at all.
Exactly. Well, yeah. Well, it's the fourth of the Blood Red Moon, as you're saying. It's 7-7 for the Shemitah year. So maybe they have something planned to happen around that time. Now, I know there's been a large number of CEOs leaving big companies like Walmart, McDonald's. They're just retiring. You know, all of a sudden, 80-plus top men start retiring, and hedge fund managers start looking to buy land in the likes of South America or New Zealand. You know, when things like that start happening, you have to ask yourself, who, there's people there who have the knowledge, on the inside knowledge, they know what's coming down the line. And whether it's September, might not be September, could be October. But what we're seeing with the markets at the moment is very kind of volatile. And I'd be just curious now over the next few weeks. We've heard from one guy looking at the actual markets. Puerto Rico were in trouble financially. They can't pay the debt back. And Mexico owe something like 500 billion or something. And they can't, apparently this guy said in the next week and a half, which is probably in the next week, that Mexico will default and start the domino effect across the world regarding not be able to make payments for the outstanding debt. So maybe it will all kick off. I don't know what you're hearing from your side.
Well, I hope so. I'd like to see it. I mean, nobody should pay their debt to the IMF. The IMF is a scam. It's there to milk the wealth of the world. It never lent anybody anything. It's all just a fictional debt-based system anyway. All the wealth that the banks own is ill-gotten. And I'd like to see everybody default on the IMF. I'd like to see the IMF go out of existence. I really would. It's caused an immense amount of damage around the planet. I'd like to see some sort of honest monetary system perhaps lead us back to a point where we don't need money.
Yeah.
But that's a kind of an alien concept for a lot of people. I mean, I don't really have a problem with money. Anything that we can pass around to each other to, you know, for perceived value, it's fine by me. IOUs, seashells, whatever. But a debt-based, privately run debt-based currency such as we've got now is completely unacceptable because it creates this state of perceived scarcity which leads to endless wars, endless resource exploitation and all the problems that we've got now. So we need to address this very quickly. So I hope they do default. I'd like to see all countries default.
Well, we've said this before on the show, and I think you're bang on there. It's all about scarcity. If they can turn around and say to you that this is very scarce, they can up the value of the item. And obviously people are jumping and screaming. You know, like, I suppose, if there is a crisis, you know, there'd be a lack of food. And there'd be queues, very, very long queues for people queuing up wanting to get food for their family and everything else, when there possibly will be no scarcity because they'll be stockpiling everything and just using that as an excuse. Like the oil, I suppose, in the end of the day, they're saying that, oh, we're going to run out of oil, the price goes up, they make loads of money, and all of a sudden they find another oil well, and then the price comes down again. And it's all mind control, scarcity. And we've mentioned this before.
It is. It's all mind control. It's all scarcity. Personally, I believe oil is abiotic. I don't think it's a fossil fuel at all. I mean, how many trees and dinosaurs are they trying to tell us died? How many are down there, you know?
Yeah.
It's ridiculous. There's never been one oil well that's gone dry. I think peak oil is a complete scam. Oil is abiotic. It's produced in the core. The wells are replenished all the time, and it should be the cheapest fuel on the planet. The price is artificially inflated in order to get these certain Arab cartels on the side. This is why Saudi Arabia is so close to America, because the Saudis are able to live like kings, and it's virtually like almost like a slave culture in Saudi Arabia and Dubai. You've got these rich Arabs who treat all the people around them like slaves, and they're able to do so because of the massively inflated price of oil, which should be a very, very cheap fuel. Our cars should simply be made to be efficient, which they could do. They could be non-pollutive and efficient. We don't need, you know, all these problems, all of this stuff, man. It's all the result of all this rubbish and legislation government's put in place. So we've got to stand up and call it for what it is. The whole oil thing is a scam. It's all inflated. All the prices are inflated. Don't believe anything the media tells you or anything the government tells you. And again, you know, it's an opportunity. All these things are opportunities for us. So
exactly.
We've got to start calling them out for what they are and standing up and calling a spade and link all our communities together into some positive action, grassroots action, everybody everywhere, and start, you know, going for the throat of these politicians and asking them to show cause where they should not be held accountable for this mess they've created. So they keep telling us we're the problem. No, you're the problem. It's because mankind has done all this bad stuff, so you've got to go home and use a special light bulb and a special shopping bag for life, because, you know, we've created all this pollution. Really, it's the corporations that's created it. It's the government legislation that's created it. All the people have done is do what the government told them to do, used and consumed the products the government provided for them to consume, And it's created all these problems, and it's been done on purpose.
Yeah.
So that now we can view ourselves as our own worst enemy and believe that we need this nanny state to look after us, you know. It's a scam, the whole thing.
And that's the programming. I mean, we are in a fascist state at the moment, the way things are, with the banks and the corporations controlling everything, and the politicians being puppets on a string. But we have more questions for you, Max, so we'll pop over to Chris. Or not Chris, over
we'll to... We'll pop over to Chris.
Over to Steve. Where'd they get
we'll
that from?
We'll pop over to Chris.
Where'd they
it's
get that from?
It's been 5 years.
I know. Sorry, mate.
Jesus. Anyway, yes, I know, you're just reading you're reading some of the questions on the chat room that's coming in from Chris.
Yeah.
Yes, you are, and that's okay. But we're going to go to a question, Max, from a new listener called El Grambino, and he wants to say, he or she wants to know, can you ask Max if he believes the Djinn or Dracos are manipulating the Cabal / Illuminati?
Look, again, this is something that I can speculate on, but all I can do is speculate. I have no first-hand information.
Right.
You know, if you're going to go to off-world stuff and whether our leaders are being manipulated, maybe. Maybe there's something like that. Maybe it's the Archons. Maybe it's Wetiko, like the Native Americans talk about, the you know, white man's disease that makes us do things that we know are bad for us, but we do it anyway.
Yeah.
And maybe that's the source of evil. There's all I can do is speculate. There could be something that manipulates our mind, but to think that there's something there that does that, sometimes I believe can be disempowering for people. You might think, well, there's no way out. If it's this off-world alien species controlling us, there's no way out. I think there is a way out. I think that it doesn't matter whether it's mind parasites, whether it's Archons, whether it's Draconians, or what it is. What matters is what we do about it. What matters is where our focus is. And our focus needs to be on our own empowerment. And by respecting ourselves enough to see the value in ourselves enough to see the value in others, so that we can unite as one cohesive, respectful community in a united, cohesive response. And stop thinking we're the resistance to this. You know, I get this in the alternate media as well, we're the resistance. Well, I'm not the resistance, I'm the response team. You know, I'm not resisting. Like, resistance is a loaded term.
Yeah.
You're resisting that which is inevitable. No, I'm responding. That's what Full Circle Project is, full spectrum response.
Yep.
So, yeah, maybe it is Dracos, maybe it's Archons, maybe it's whatever, but I don't care. I'm gonna step above it and then go on down.
Okay, well, that link that you sent over, the link you gave earlier, I've popped that up on the chat room so people will be aware that they can check out that link later on. Just a quick one in here from Joan. Joan is wondering, is Max aware that no media has spoken about this on Austria getting almost 300,000 signatures in order to hold a referendum to stay or leave the EU? I'm not aware of that. Anyway, are you aware of that, Max?
No, I heard a vague talk about it, but that's the first confirmation I've had from it from somebody else. But yeah, the media won't ever, you know, the revolution will not be televised. That's
no.
The thing.
Yeah.
So that's another thing. We've got to listen to the alternative media. We've got to understand that there are people out there that are doing this, and there are people out there that think like you. A lot is changing, but it's not being televised. So don't lose hope. Don't lose faith. Don't lose faith. Don't think there are people, you know, you're alone out there and that people aren't acting, because they are. It's just not being televised. It's not being spoken about in the newspapers. But, you know, if you can go to online chat rooms and speak to people on the ground in all these places, you'll find that people are on the move and we are making a difference.
I totally agree. I mean, we are kind of, we're like a, well, we started off kind of like a small little army, but I think it has grown now to a massive size, because we see it here every week. We have people on the chat room here. We have the people's internet radio chat room. And like, it's sometimes, depending on what the subject is, it's kind of like we're preaching to the converted, you know, a lot of times, because there's so many people that are away to all this. But it's a case of, as we always say, planting seeds as well. Like, there's a lot of people that we would know, Alan and I would know, outside of and away from OYM, who are kind of still hardwired into the Matrix. And, you know, even those people, we haven't given up hope for those. We still kind of plant seeds. And, you know, even if it's just things like the austerity, we're educating people as to, you know, what they can do in relation to austerity and stuff. And even little things like that, and the water meter charges, you know, some people have actually started to wake up from that. You know, they're realizing, hang on a second, what's the government up to? And then, you know, once they're kind of a little bit awake, then we can give them more information. And, you know,
exactly. Yeah. That's the beauty of all this. And what you got to do, rather than speaking to the choir all the time, like what you got to do is you got to speak in a language they can understand. That's why I've been using this whole abuse of office and national security, you know, concept, because I'm trying to speak to the guys on the street who are asleep. Once you get them to realize this, so that, yeah, this is actually an abuse of office, and I'm suffering because of someone I actually employ to manage infrastructure for me. It's a new way of looking at it, and you see this little empowering light go off inside them, and then they're open to a little bit more information. But you got to speak to the people on the street in a language they can understand. That is so important. And if we can get that ball rolling, then we're a huge force to be reckoned with, and these criminals will have no chance at all. And I think they're doing it themselves, man. They're giving us every opportunity to wake these people up. All we have to do is use language they can understand. People are sort of, their heads are spinning. They're going, something's terribly wrong. Why are we all suddenly suffering so much at the hands of our government? Suddenly you start talking to them about abuse of office and public trustees and the role of management of infrastructure and all this sort of stuff. And they start thinking, yeah, actually, this is really what's going on. This is really a different way of looking at it. And they're not actually my rulers. They're my employees.
Yeah.
And why am I suffering at their hands? And you see this ball really start rolling. Then they're open to more, more esoteric information. So that's what I've been trying to do with this. So good on you. And it's great to see so many people doing it. And we are making a difference, man. We are.
Definitely.
The media is just snowballing. It really is. And the mainstream is just, it's just rolling out. It's not doing anything. It's, the numbers are dropping. Nobody's watching it anymore. You've got mainstream media organizations such as Fox News that aren't even getting half the numbers that many alternate media personalities are getting. So it's been phenomenal to see the shift.
Yeah, of course, the backlash of that is if we're getting more views and more hits than they're getting, then obviously they're going to petition Congress, and then there's going to be more laws written, and again, they're probably going to come after the likes of us and the likes of yourself, and, you know, try and shut us down or regulate us in some way, shape, or form.
Of course, they're trying to do that all the time. I just disregard it. I just ask them to show cause why I should bother with anything they say or do, because they're a bunch of criminals.
Yeah.
You know, that's it. I mean, people ask me why I don't vote. I've had people come and knock on my door and we say, we believe there's someone here not registered to vote. And I say, yes, that's me. I don't vote because I refuse to support organized crime. And that's it. And that's the way I deal with them. And if you want to take me to court and talk about this, fine. We can go to a public court. We'll talk about it publicly. You know, because I can prove and back up everything I say. And I'm not going to bow to you. I'm not going to kowtow to you. I'm not going to play by your rules because you're a bunch of criminals. You're all in abusive office. Show cause why you should be held in abuse of office and charged with all that. So once you've cleared up the fact for me that you are not in abuse of office and are not supporting war crimes, then we can look at whatever your charges may be against me. But as far as I'm concerned, you're a criminal, which has caused me to do what I do. And I'm happy to talk about this as public as possible if you want to. And that's my attitude towards these people. I have no fear of them. I will not step backwards to them, and I'll call them what they are.
And if you found yourself, Max, with an invitation at some point to go to a court, what way would you treat that? Would you go to the court, or would you just view it as an invitation and just chuck it in the bin?
Look, I don't know. I'd have to deal with it at the time. I might go there, but I wouldn't step into the dock. I would go there and I'd be the living human being in the court. But I'd go there to clear up what this problem was they had with my name. But I don't know. I don't even know whether I would. I don't know. I'd have to. It'd depend on the circumstances. But as far as taxes and all that sort of stuff goes, I need them to show cause that they are not committing war crimes. I need them to show cause that they should not be held accountable for all the things that I can prove they are doing. You know, and I say that to them when they write me letters, and I just don't hear from them again. So I don't know. I guess something works, but that's the attitude that I always take. I won't take a backward step to these people. They're criminals. I won't support them. I won't vote for them. I won't pay taxes to them, because if I support this system in any way at all, then I'm supporting their criminal cabal, and that's just the way it is.
Okay. Just out of curiosity, when they do send you these letters, do you use the return to sender process?
No, I just send the letter in and basically tell them off. and state what I feel.
Yeah.
I'm not like all the Freeman stuff. I tried all that. I mean, I think the Freeman stuff, it's all been useful at exposing the fiction. But basically, I'll just write a letter back and say, hey, look, you're a criminal. Show cause why I shouldn't hold you accountable for this, 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 and this. And once we've cleared this up, then I'm happy to talk. And I don't hear back from them.
So you call it as you see, you shoot from the hip, basically.
Yeah, I just call it from as I see it. You know, and right. I use their first name. I don't address their office. Dear Honourable Sir, bullshit, I'll call you Peter or whatever your name is, you know.
Yeah.
So I just do that and say, look, you know, this is what's going on, and you're a criminal, and I'm not gonna party with you. And they don't write back to me. I don't know. Maybe it's just my attitude. I don't know. Maybe they'll come and get me with a big swag of charges one day. Say, look, we've got these 7 years of all these abusive letters you've sent to us, and all. Maybe they're coming for me. Who knows?
Well, I'm guessing if they do, you won't go.
Chapter, mate, you know.
If they do come for you, they'll kick in and scream, and I'd say.
Yeah, yeah, it'll just be the next chapter. But yeah. I'm not going to play by their rules. I'm not going to kowtow to these terrorists and these psychopaths. You know, you're pandering to criminals if you play by their rules. I firmly believe that.
Yeah, no, I think you're right, and I know there's thousands more that believe that way as well. Just want to move on with the questions because we've as Alan says, we're watching the time and we've a few more to get through. John is just wondering, this is one come up there earlier on. John is wondering, what does Max think, or who does Max think is behind all the heavy chemtrail spraying?
Good question. I think the chemtrails is all part of the whole transhumanist agenda. I think this all ties in with Jay's Helm, all the AI. I firmly believe there's nanotech in the chemtrails. I've got a film that I put out in 2014, I think, called Transformation, where I spoke a lot about chemtrails. Now, I don't know who's behind it. I think the scientific community, Monsanto, the military-industrial complex, all sorts of people are behind it. I think it's a multi-platform delivery system for all types of things. There are people who say they're doing it to protect us from global warming and the fact that they've destroyed the ozone, blah, blah, blah. I don't think so. I think that's a joke. But yeah, I don't know. Hard to say who's behind it. I mean, the plant, they seem to come out of everywhere. There seems to be an additive they're putting into fuel. So I'm not sure. But whoever's controlling the whole banking system, whoever's controlling the whole thing, I mean, if there is Archons or Draconians or whatever, then it's probably them. But like I said, I can only speculate. That's a mystery. That's something that is so much in people's faces, but it's so difficult to wake them up. It's a really in-your-face thing. You're being sprayed. It's right there. The lines are in the sky, and yet everybody is in denial of it. And it's amazing. It's right in your face, and it's the most difficult thing to talk about. And it's one of the most hidden.
Oh, it is. Hidden in plain sight.
Go to these airports and see who runs these planes. You don't know where they're coming from. That's the problem, you know.
Yeah, we actually have some software here. I think it's freely available on the internet. And when planes are going, planefinder.net, it's a website, sorry, it's not software, it's planefinder.net. And when these planes are going over in your sky, you can check them out in Planefinder. And a lot of the times we've actually noticed that the identifications of the plane doesn't actually come up. So you don't know exactly who's doing it or why they're doing it. But yeah, I mean, look, as the saying goes, they're hiding it in plain sight. It's there for all to see. We actually had Max about 2 years ago, I think, on our mainstream media station over here. They do the news and then followed by the weather forecast. And the weather forecast, the girl who was on there doing the weather, she made reference to, because they'd been inundated with phone calls. It was like a mass phone call. It was just loads of calls made to the station. People were wanting to know what was all these white things up in the sky, these big, mad, long trails. And they got so many phone calls that they had to address it on mainstream. So the girl come on, she's doing the weather forecast, and she says, oh, yeah, there's been a lot of activity from the, I think, what was it, from the airplanes in the sky today, and people were commenting on the trails, and they're condensation trails from the planes. And she went on to give a brief description on contrails, but you could see by her demeanour and the way she spoke that even she didn't believe what she was saying. She knew better, because, I mean, she's obviously a meteorologist. There we go. Yeah, she's one of them people.
Yeah. Well, they know. I mean, a lot of them know. You can't get on there and say that this is normal because it's just not, you know.
Yeah, no, it's a bit mad when they're right in front of your face. We have about 10 minutes left, Max, and we want to kind of focus on solutions. And I know you were talking about something that you want to get together and get out there. Can you tell us a bit more about it?
The Full Circle Project.
Yeah.
The Full Circle Project, like I said, it's a mechanism by which people can use, like it's a platform that we can use to connect our communities together. We can form action groups and we can obtain the right focus of these action groups. I firmly believe that, you know, if we can change the meme, you know, change the state of human empowerment, change the human condition, we can make a difference. People just have to remember who they are. They've got to remember that they have power and remember that if we unite in a cohesive response, a coordinated response, we can make a difference. And there's so many movements that people start, and they don't go anywhere. You know, it's someone, you know, getting up there and saying, well, this reality doesn't work. Here's my version of a new reality. Let's all get on board and make this happen. But it's got to be an organic thing. You can't script what the future looks like. You've just got to let the future unfold, but you've got to approach it with the right attitude. And our problem is we don't have the right attitude. So at Full Circle Project, I'm trying to get all of the groups out there, all the action groups that are out there doing their stuff, to shift their focus to what has caused the problem, which has created the need for them to act, you know, for them to go and put a Band-Aid on this symptom, because that's all we're doing is we're putting Band-Aids on symptoms. We're sending charity packages to countries that have been destroyed by corporations rather than addressing the legislation which allowed the corporation to go and destroy the country, and holding the people who did it and created the problem accountable for their actions. We're going and milking the wealth of more people in order to try to put a Band-Aid on a problem that's been created by government. So we've got to really shift our focus. That's what I'm trying to do with this. So, I mean, I think there's a way out of this mess if we can present the truth to people, to man on the street, or at least a portion of the truth, at least an opening, a doorway to the truth, in a manner they can understand, in an empowering enough manner, in a way that they can see there's a light at the end of the tunnel, and a way that will inspire them to get motivated and to act. Because if we can do this, we can shift things. Like I said, we don't need to build a new system. We need to shift our perspective, and the system will change around us. So we need a movement that is not a movement, a movement that is simply grass fires, a movement that doesn't have a leader, no one telling you what to do. And what we've got with Full Circle Project is we've got the community connector, and you can, like, I get so many emails from people saying, there's no one in my area, do you know someone in my area I can talk to? Well, you can log on to the community connector, you can put in your postcode, and you can find someone in your area to talk to. You can form an action group, you can do a search for 1 mile, 2 miles, 5 miles, 20 miles, your whole country, whatever. Find people in your area who want to get involved in groups and want to form action groups. And then we've got templates, how you can form circles of five and how you can actually do it. And you can make these action groups happen. You can get their focus and you can get it all linked up and we can do it globally. So it's a movement that has no leaders. It's a mechanism and a resource hub for people. And it's something that I believe can make a difference if we can all get involved. So that's what Full Circle Project is all about.
Funny you're talking about getting people involved. We were dealing with energy today, obviously, with the Pain Genie. And one of the things that came up during the conversation was the fact that people seem to have a lack of energy, obviously with the crap that they're eating in the diet, because all the food is all kind of processed and we're not eating the proper food, which takes away our energy. So people don't have the energy to get up and do something. All planned by the cabal and the global elites. I mean, they know what they're doing. And that's what we find over here. We find that there is a number of people who are kind of I'm okay jacks, who, because it's not affecting them, they won't really get involved. And then there's other people who really won't really get involved because they just say, I can't be bothered, I don't really have the energy to do that, you know. And again, the bad food and our bad diet and the environment we're in can all zap our energy. And I'm sure you've come across this. Have you got any solutions yourself as to how you came over this or got over this?
Look, you know, just trying to eat good food is a really big part about it, trying to eat good food. There's nothing edible in the supermarket. Just don't go there. Try not to buy anything with a package on it. I know it's very difficult. But, you know, eating good food and you know, raw juices and raw smoothies and all this sort of stuff really helps. I see a question there that you posted there. A few more cues. Thomas Sheridan says DMT is bad for humanity. Does Max agree? I actually think plant medicines are very good for you. I don't agree with smoking DMT. Some people do it. I did it a couple of times just to see what it was. I think it's useful in as much as it allows you to know that there's a lot more to reality, but it's not something that I do. But the thing is, if we were eating normal food and drinking normal food and all the things I just mentioned, our pineal would be open and we would have more DMT flowing in our body anyway, and so we would see reality a little bit differently to what we do. I do think there is a lot to be learned from dreams, but there's also a lot to be learned from certain plant medicines as well.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I think juicing, and we've talked about this before, and we've had people on, like Bernard Bowen, talking about juicing and the benefits of it, and we have to go back to the natural food, organic as much as we can, grow our own. Although in America, they're trying to bring in a law to stop that, people from growing their own, because they're saying that, you know, if you grow your own, you give to a neighbor, and that neighbor dies, who's responsible? This is the excuse they're using, because it's the nanny state again.
Yeah, the nanny state again. And even, like, growing organic food, it's all very well, but if they're spraying chemicals in the sky, then it's still all in your organic food. That's the thing. You know, and even when you're buying organic food from the supermarket, you can, you know, they can still grow GM food organically. So you've really got to look at what you're doing and look at what you're buying. And a lot of people in cities just haven't got the opportunity to do that. So a lot of them just can't grow organic food, you know.
Yeah. But I think overall, I think we all have to agree that even in the last 5 years, there's been a massive awakening of people. I mean, we keep hearing about the energies hitting the planet. And a lot of people waking up and asking the questions, what's going on? I know we're seeing an awful lot of it here in Ireland, but globally I think that's going on, especially with all the protests that are going on in different countries, and people are saying, no more austerity, enough is enough. So I do think that we are on the way up. I do think that that there is change taking place globally, and I do think that the cabal on the elitists are on the back foot at the moment. I think they're like a trapped rat in the corner, and they're doing all they can to try and stop this tide happening of people waking up. But look, change is inevitable. It's going to happen.
Well, it is, and I think that the future is not as dark as everyone believes it is, but it will be if we don't act. So we do need to act. There are a lot of people are waking up, but they need a focus, and that's what I'm trying to provide for them with Full Circle Project. So, yeah, we've got to be able to link ourselves up together, put all our cards on the table together, and come up with workable solutions. So, you know, there isn't any one person out there that has all the answers, but together, if we put all our minds together and we act with respect and we coordinate ourselves properly, we can bring about some difference, we can bring about some change. So I think the future looks very bright, because there's so many people waking up. And the more the government attempts to lock us down, the more people will they wake up. You know, people are realizing that we're ruled by a cacistocracy. That's what it is. It's not even an oligarch. It's a cacistocracy. And a cacistocracy is defined as governance by the worst elements of society, exclusively for their own interests and to the permanent detriment of all other classes. And that's what we've got. We're ruled by the worst people possible. And people are beginning to see that there is a way out if we put down our differences and unite with some respect and simply call a spade a spade, call things what they are, and be prepared to stand up and be counted. If we can do that, then we'll get out of this very quickly. But if people are waiting for someone to come and lead them to safety, then they're going to be waiting for a long time, because there's no real leaders in this. This is an opportunity for us to lead ourselves. Now, if you're not capable of your own redemption and capable of your own freedom, then why would you ever think you deserve it? So yeah, it's time to stand up and be counted. It really is. This is humanity's greatest challenge. It's one of the greatest times in history to be alive. It's one of the greatest opportunities we've ever been given. So please, if you're out there listening, please do get involved.
Yeah, definitely. Well, it's a grassroots movement from the ground up, and we can't rely on the politicians, we can't rely on the governments. We have to do it ourselves, and we are seeing, myself and Steve, have seen, even down to sending an email to somebody, how that has changed somebody's life. And got them thinking and going down a different path. So the even the power of the email, the word especially, but the email, is incredible how much that actually makes a difference. But just getting out there and meeting like-minded people. I mean, we met today. We had 2 days of training, and we met like-minded people, and we're all sharing information. And now everybody's going back with a piece of information that they learned that they didn't know the day before. I mean, this is what's happening. So it's a grassroots movement. And, well, I'd just like to say, Max, we've run out of time, but thanks for coming on the show and all you're doing, and what you have been doing over the years, and educating people and doing the radio shows and obviously being in places like Palestine and getting involved in that and educating people. It's fantastic that you've done so much, and, you know, may you continue a long time. And what you're doing there. So we appreciate you coming on the show. I'm going to pass you over to Steve, and Steve's going to get all your details off you, so we can let people know where they can find you.
Yeah, again, Max, I want to echo Alan's sentiments. It's been absolutely fantastic. Lots of positive information coming in through the chat room there, lots of good questions as well, and we didn't get to ask so many. I do apologize. But, you know, it's all good information, and you're doing it day after day, and fair play, kudos to you. We do have the information here that I have posted up. I will put it up again, the link to the Indiegogo, the fundraiser, and also your website, thecrowhouse.com. Is there any other information that you want to impart on us before you leave us this evening?
No, that's about it. The crowhouse.com is where you'll find all my work. That Indiegogo campaign, that's a friend of mine in Gaza Strip who's trying to get enough money to buy a camera so that he can get himself some employment. It's like 44% unemployment rate in Gaza. It's very hard. So it's very hard for him to raise $1,500 he needs for a camera. So if anyone could throw him a couple of bucks, it would be really good. Yeah. You can go to the website, fullcircleproject.net. to sign up for the Full Circle Project. We're in a process of still building that site, so please do get involved in that. And you'll find out everything from me and all the information that I put out there, all the radio shows, the interviews, the films. It's all on thecrowhouse.com. And thanks for having me on. It's always a pleasure to come and talk to you guys.
Just one quick one before you do go, Max. You're also on theamericanvoice.com. When can people hear you on there?
I'm on there on every Friday night, late Friday nights on American Voice Radio. The name of the show is Surviving the Matrix. You'll always find it posted on the Crow House in the radio archives the next morning, and you'll always find a YouTube video put up to accompany the show as well.
Excellent
stuff. Brilliant, Max. Okay, Max, just stay with us there for a minute, and we'll pop over to a musical break, and we'll be back after this.
This is Open Your Mind Radio on OYMRadio.com, UnitedWeStrike.com, and PeoplesInternetRadio.com.
Right, said Fred. There's no homes to go to. A little bit of right, said Fred, for all the sexy men that's listening in this evening and all the women who are looking for sexy men. There's loads of them on our chat room, actually. They're all wearing OYM t-shirts.
Fantastic.
We've got a few of those left, if anyone wants them.
Yeah, we have a few t-shirts left, so if you want a t-shirt, pop over to the shop there and you can pick one up. We just have a few left.
Yeah, you won't find these in pennies.
Exactly. Now, next week we have the legend that is Art Bell.
Now, Art Bell, the real Art Bell from...
The real Art Bell.
Oh, my God.
The real Art Bell. Now, some of you will know who Art Bell is. And some of you will probably not know who Art Bell is. But I'm going back to... God, it must have been early 2000s when I was using dial-up modems before we had ADSL and broadband. And I would dial up in the early hours of the morning to listen to Art Bell and his show on the internet. And he's a legend. He's been around a long time. A lot of things went on, but he's back in the air in the States. And I sent him a message and I asked Art, would he come on and, give the show a plug and tell us all about what he's been up to and, everything else. So he's agreed to come back on. So we're going to chase him up this week, and fingers crossed he'll be able to make it next Sunday, and we'll have him on, and we'll be talking to a real radio host legend who knows all about the stuff that we've been talking about. He's been doing it for years. He's been doing it for a very long time. So it's going to be great having Art on. So it'll be great fun for next week. Now, what else is happening during the week. We've nothing, there's nothing planned, but as usual with OEM, you never know what's coming around the corner. But I know myself and Steve are going to be focusing on the Pain Genie and probably getting the word out there for people if they are suffering as well. Now, we found out also, which is a kind of bonus, is that the Pain Genie can be used as like a Bob Beck protocol blood electrifier. And if you don't know that, pop over to YouTube and type in Bob Beck, Blood Electrifier, the Electrifier, and you'll and have a look at the documentary that Bob Beck did about what he did and the amount of cures he did with the Electrifier. And apparently the Pain Genie can be used for that as well. And the reason why myself and Steve are very enthusiastic over it, and other people say, why do you keep talking about the Pain Genie, is because, you know, you won't believe the amount of treatments that you can treat. And when people go and say they're in pain from a 0 to a 10, what pain are you? And somebody might say, I'm a 7 or an 8. And then Richard would, for a few minutes, treat that person with the genie. And then Richard would say, what pain are you in now? And they say, well, I've no pain. The pain's gone. I mean, it's that good. So if you can get a demo, or if you know somebody in pain, send them over to the paingenie.com website and get them to have a look at the testimonials and what's being said. And if a group of you can get together and buy a Pain Genie and work together between you, I mean, that would be the ideal solution. Because if what's coming down the line, and we heard what Max said about the Blood Red Moon, Super Shemitah and all that kind of stuff, and we know the financial system is probably near a crash. And if you can't get food, you can't get water, if you can't go to your doctors to get your, you know, pain relief or painkillers or anything like that, then somebody that has a Pain Genie is going to be worth their weight in gold if they can treat any symptoms. Now, they're not going to be able to treat everything, but general pain issues, ligaments and you know, bits and pieces like that, you know, any pain related issues on the body, you can give it a good treatment, and let's see what happens, you know. But I do think that you know, it, we do talk about it, but there's so many benefits of the Pain Genie. But it was, I have to say, this was a very busy weekend for myself and Steve, a very enjoyable weekend. Friday night, brilliant feat with Mac, thanks Gary, and the 2 days of training, thanks Adam for that. And again, for the people who are regular donators to OYM, a big thank you for that, because it does keep the wheels in motion and it does allow us to run things like seminars, which we did in Navan. Now, we're going to plan to have another Pain Genie seminar probably in the next few months, maybe, because the seminar that we did just fell on the summer solstice, the Kells Road Race and Father's Day, and maybe that's why we didn't get as many as we thought we would. So we might run it again. So if anybody's interested in going to a seminar, just send us an email, let us know. And it's going to be a free seminar. We'll do a free seminar because we want people to go there to check it out. And this time we'll try and arrange it that when nothing else is on, just fingers crossed. But that'd be fair enough to say, Steve, I think.
Yes, that would be very fair to say. Because it's all about giving back. I mean, people have been, as Alan said, people have been very, very kind and generous to us over the past 5 years, and especially this weekend for all the people who we've already thanked who know who they are. It was an energy boost, I suppose, in one way to us, and we really appreciate it. So I mean, if we can organise something at some stage, even if it's just a small little event like another seminar for the Pain Genie or something, anything that, you know, we will try and do something. And obviously it'll be free, and it's just our way of kind of giving back to you and saying thanks, because you know, at the end of the day, you all out there are tuning in every Sunday and listen to us gabble on for, as Adam says, gabble on for 2 hours. So,
well, that was one of the things that the people in the Pain Genie seminar said to us, and they said, you know, how do you feel about, you know, what OIM does and, you know, getting the word out there and the impact that OIM has? And myself and Steve kind of said, well, we don't really know, because we go into the studio and we do the show and then we go back to life and we get on with, you know, doing, being daddy and all that kind of stuff. And we get we get a couple of emails in saying enjoyed the show and all that kind of stuff. And that's about it. It's only when we go to something like a seminar or we go and do a talk somewhere, that people ask, you know, they say, you know, the benefit of having the guests on the show. So it's great getting some positive feedback like that, saying that what we do is enjoyable and it is making a difference and people are doing things. So it is great getting that feedback. Now, one of the things myself and Steve talked about and said that we would offer, if there's anybody out there that has a group of people that do you want myself and Steve to come and have a chat with them, you know, you might have a group of friends that are open-minded, and if you like myself and Steve to come down and do a chat, and you can talk to us about any subject or any guests that we had on the show or any issues that are out there, we're more than happy to do that. So if you want to organise something, you know, if you have 10 plus friends or whatever, or people that are open-minded, and you want us to come down and do an informal chat, we're more than happy to do that, because again, we want to spread the word and we want to educate as many people as we can, not just in the studio, although we do stuff outside the studio. You know, we want to kind of be probably more proactive and start getting the word out there as we go, I think.
Yeah, it's all we can do at the end of the day. Just kind of, it's giving back. Like, okay, we've learned, as you say, thanks to a listener, we've learned a lot of information over this weekend, and, you know, it's not information that we want to keep to ourselves, it's information that we want to share, and if somebody, as Alan said, if someone out there it would benefit from a treatment, let us know. If we can get to you, great, and, you know, that's what it's all about.
Definitely. Okay, so we're going to wrap things up. Art Bell next week. Don't forget to tune in. If there's any information, any links, anything that we need to know, send it over to us. Any suggestions for guests, take it easy, stay safe, and see you next week. This is Alan James signing off. Take care. Bye bye.
Yeah, stay tuned to People's Internet Radio. Vin is up next. I checked with him who's on. He said it's just himself at the moment, and he's going to be on video, so that's going to be a treat for all the ladies. You can see the man behind the golden voice. So stay tuned. If you're listening on the People's Internet Radio stream, we'll be switching over momentarily. If you're listening on the UWS or the OYM stream, it's been a pleasure having you. And we'll do it all again next week. So yeah, that's it. And I'll sign off as well. And then we'll play the theme tune. Right, so for myself, Stephen George, again, it's been an absolute pleasure. We'll do it all again next week. Until then, take care. Bye-bye.